各位法师，各位师兄，大家晚上好。首先请大家发菩提心。
Good evening to all teachers and students this evening. May we all begin by making an aspiration of bodhicitta.
我们每一天上课的时候都要给大家提醒要发菩提心。
Making the aspiration of bodhicitta is something we have to remind ourselves at the beginning of each teaching.
因为这个菩提心对我们修大乘佛教的这个佛教徒来说非常非常的重要，所以我们每一天都要提醒大家修菩提心。
The reason is that bodhicitta is extremely important to us as students of the Mahayana tradition, so it's something that we need to remind ourselves of every day.
那么学佛的时候我们很多时候就当我们还没有去学习思考修心，尤其是我们没有闻和思的时候呢大家都不知道学佛到底要学什么。
Before we've really begun to engage in the process of studying and reflecting on the contents of the Buddha's teachings, many people really don't have much idea of what it is they should in fact be studying.
这是因为我们还没有去学习实际上如果我们稍微投入一点去学习的话，那么修行的这个路已经讲得非常非常清楚了。
But this is only because we haven't begun to properly study yet. Once we just apply ourselves to this with a little bit of diligence, then the path of practice will emerge with clarity.
修心的路啊，已经讲得很清楚，一点都不模糊。只要我们自己能够修的话，修心的方法呢，已经讲得非常清楚了。
The path of practice is in fact already set out for us in very clear terms. As long as we're willing to commit ourselves to this path, it's spelled out for us very clearly.
那么修心啊，我们不管是修藏传佛教也好，汉传佛教也好，我们大家就是要修出离心、菩提心，还有就是真无空性的见解，就这三个。
Regardless of whether we're students of the Chinese Buddhist tradition or the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, either way, what we have to study and practice are these three principal aspects of the path: renunciation.Bodhicitta and a correct view of emptiness.
那么出离心呢，简单的说就是我们下决心啊，我一定要解脱啊，我一定要解脱，我一定要这个从轮回苦海生老病死的这个痛苦当中，我一定要解脱啊，就有这样子的决心，就是出离心。
The resolve, the strong resolve.To achieve liberation and to completely turn oneself away from all thoughts of samsaric existence is what we mean when we refer to renunciation.
那么我们从这个轮回当中想解脱的这种想法，有些时候呢非常非常的强烈，有些时候呢虽然不是这么强烈，但是呢还是一直都有一直都有这个想法。这样子的话呢，那么我们就是已经走上了解脱的道路，已经有了出离心了。
Sometimes this feeling of renunciation will be more intense, other times not as intense, but if in general this aspiration is always with us to some extent, then we can consider ourselves to have already started out along the path to liberation.
然后第二个菩提心呢，我们昨天讲了就是如果我自己一个人从这个轮回当中能够得到解脱也意义不是很大，所以我要让天下所有的众生解脱就有这样子的想法和决心。
Bodhicitta, as we mentioned last night, refers to the aspirationto lead all living beings from suffering. Achieving liberation just for ourselves is not very meaningful.
然后呢，如果我要想让天下的众生都要成佛的话，那么从目前的情况来看，我们就是没有这样子的能力。那么没有能力，我们应该怎么办呢？就是我们从现在开始学佛我们想成佛成了佛以后呢，能够让天下所有的众生都可以成佛，逐渐逐渐的都可以成佛。所以我一定要成佛从现在开始，我为了成佛学佛修心打坐有这样子的决心就叫做菩提心。
However, in terms of benefiting other living beings, based on our current level of capacity, we really aren't in a position to be able to do much. So it's for this reason that we make the aspiration to achieve Buddhahood in order for us to be able to help and benefit other beings most effectively. Once we have achieved Buddhahood for ourselves, then we will be in a position gradually to lead other beings towards Buddhahood. So it's for this reason that we engage in our Buddhist study and practice.
那么这两个出离心和菩提心，这两个心就是我们的学佛的基础也就是我们的修行的基础，也就是大乘佛教和小乘佛教的这个精华。如果没有这个出离心的话，那就根本就不叫小乘佛教小乘佛教都不是。如果没有菩提心，那么根本就不叫大乘佛教。所以这两个就是我们的学佛的核心已经讲得特别清楚了，就是需要这两个。
As students of Buddhism, renunciation and bodhicitta are the foundations of our practice. Without renunciation, we wouldn't have the Hinayana tradition, and without bodhicitta, we wouldn't have the Mahayana tradition. So it's these two combined that form the basis of our Buddhist practice.
那么我们这一生当中啊，我们大家都有机会啊，这个听闻佛法，然后呢，有机会去打坐，有机会去发出离心和发菩提心啊，这个就是一个，的确是一个啊，非常不容易的，是千载难逢的机会。
The fact in this lifetime that we have the opportunity to hear the Dharma, to practice it in meditation.To work on generating renunciation and bodhicitta, the fact that we have this opportunity, we're extremely lucky. This is a once in a blue moon opportunity.
佛经里面常说啊，人生难得，佛法难闻，啊，我们获得一个这样子的人生也是非常非常不容易的。然后呢，获得了人生以后啊，能够听到正法啊。是更加的不容易的。
The Buddhist tradition, the Buddhist teachings frequently stress the rareness and the preciousness of a human rebirth, and not only the fact of having a human rebirth, but moreover having the chance to listen and study the Buddhist teachings.
那么我们这一生当中呢，啊，既有人生啊，又有听闻佛法的机会啊，那么这个就是。非常的不容易，所以我们必须要懂得，珍惜这样子的机会。
The fact that we have human births, the fact that we also have the chance to listen and study the Dharma is, we're extremely fortunate, and it's important that we learn how to cherish this wonderful opportunity we have.
那么这一生当中，我们有这样子的机会。也不是偶然的机会，这就是我们自己在过去的多时累劫当中积累了很多很多的福报，积累了很多很多的这个资粮，这些因缘今天成熟了，成熟的时候呢，我们才好不容易就有这么一次这个学佛和修行的机会。如果这个时候我们不懂得。不懂得珍惜的话，那以后什么时候再有这样子的机会，这个真的是非常非常不好说。
The fact that we have the opportunity in this lifetime to learn the Dharma is, in fact, not a coincidental happening. This chance and opportunity that we have is the result of the positive merit that we accumulated over the course of countless previous lifetimes, and it's due to the ripening of this, these positive actions and merit in this lifetime that we have the opportunity. Given the fact that this opportunity is as rare as it is, it's not something that has come to us easily at all. It's very important that we appreciate its the rareness of this opportunity and know how to cherish it.
如果这一次我们不珍惜这个机会的话，那么下一次是什么时候有这样子的机会？也许是几百万年，也许是几千万年以后才有这么一次这个机会所以这个机会是非常难得的，所以我们大家要懂得珍惜要好好的这个闻思修行。
If we don't make the most of this opportunity in this lifetime, it's really hard to say when this chance might come to us again, whether it might be in 100,000 years or 1,000,000 years or even more. So it's extremely important that we cherish, that we grasp the opportunity in this lifetime we have.
然后我们每一个人的这个生活压力大，然后工作压力也大，就是有很多很多的这个忙碌的事情。但是呢，我们如果自己愿意的话呢，在每天都有24小时，在这个当中呢，还是可以挤出一点时间来学习和修行的。
It's true that everybody has a lot of pressures in relation to their everyday lives and their work lives, etc. However, it's certainly possible within the course of a 24-hour day to lay some time aside for our Buddhist practice.
赚钱啊，积累物质财富，这个我们作为一个在家人来说是非常非常的重要，非常的重要。但是呢，还是我们在除了这个以外啊，除了赚钱和积累物质财富以外，还需要一点点时间啊，用到这个修心啊、文思上面，这个是不能没有的。
Even though making money and working towards the improvement of our material existence is important for lay practitioners, it's important that we at the same time allocate an amount of time to study and reflect on the Buddhist teachings.
那么这个修心和学习呢，我们昨天也讲过了，还是需要一个系统的学习啊。因为佛法虽然是这个出离心、菩提心这些讲得很清楚，但是呢，我们还是要去学的。如果不学的话呢，那么这个里面讲的虽然是非常的清楚，但是呢，不学我们还是不知道怎么样去修。所以还是需要用一点时间啊，去学习。
So we really need to apply ourselves to the systematic study of Buddhism, even though the teachings set out very clearly the three principal aspects of the path, renunciation, bodhicitta, and the cultivation of a proper view of emptiness. The fact is that without studying, we really won't have a clear idea of how to go about practicing these three aspects.
那么今天我们大家都有这样子的这个听大乘佛法啊、修心啊，或者这个学习这样子的机会啊，有这样子的这个机会，这个就是能够充分的说明啊，我们过去对这个大乘佛教有缘啊，对大乘佛教有缘，所以我们这一生当中稍微投入一点的话，那么每个人都真的是非常有希望的。啊，大家都有希望的，所以我们还是要稍微投入一点点啊，还是要把我们的24小时的时间当中，至少1个小时啊，1个半小时，每天在正常的情况下啊，如果比如说出差啊，或者很忙很忙啊，这样子的时候啊，没办法坚持也没有关系，通常啊就1个小时到2个小时的时间啊，用到这个修心上。这样子的话，一定会有收获的。
The fact that in this life we have the opportunity to listen to the Mahayana teachings is ample evidence of the fact, or is ample evidence of our karmic connection, in fact, with Buddhism and the Mahayana teachings in previous lifetimes. For this reason, all of us, in fact, have great hope in terms of our practice. Based on this, we really should apply some effort to studying Buddhism. This is something, if we are able to allocate between 1 or 2 hours a day to study and practice, we should receive good results.
所以我们从此以后呢，还是把自己的时间好好的安排一下，就是每天的时间当中，就需要一点点的时间1到2个小时这样子的时间用来就这个安排到这个学佛上面啊。那么学佛呢，我们平时的烧香拜佛这些。不是说这些啊，平时烧香拜佛当然是很好的。我说的这个学佛呢，就是第一个是学习啊，第二个就是打坐修心啊，这个就叫做学佛。
So, it would be wonderful if everybody would allocate their daily activities so that they were able to set aside between 1 or 2 hours for Buddhist study. And with the word study, I'm not referring to making offerings, incense offerings to the Buddha, etc. While these are all very good and well in themselves, what I mean by Buddhist study is actually learning the content of Buddhism and meditation practice.
那么我们作为一个普通人就是用佛教的话来讲，叫做凡夫凡夫俗子，就是说我们普通没有修行的普通人。那么我们普通人的眼光是非常非常 非常短，我们只懂得看这一生，看眼前，我们非常非常的在乎眼前的利益但是我们几乎都不太去想长远的所谓的长远也就不就这么几十年的几十年的这个事情，除了这个以外呢，我们不去想。但是呢，这个轮回是绝对是除了这个我们几十年以外，绝对是存在的。所以我们为了长远的事情，也得要去做一点事情。
As ordinary beings, our view, our worldview is often very, very short-term in nature or short-sighted. We're usually concerned with our interests that really only rest in a short period of time in front of us. Even if we talk about a long-term view, it's only in the context of our greater lifetime. However, cyclic existence is, in fact,a very, very long-term thing. So it's something that we should appreciate and for this reason apply ourselves.
我们任何人就是全世界七十亿人口当中包括这个哲学家包括科学家任何一个人没有能够理性的去否定这个轮回的存在没有一个是真的是那个一个很有说服力的逻辑去否定这个轮回的存在没有的那么既然没有的话呢那么我们是应该也就是为了这样子的这个这个长远的就是为了长远的这些事情我们也应该去做一点准备那么我们就只考虑眼前不去考虑长远的事情这个就是人是这样子的话是很愚昧的做法。
Of the 7 billion people in the world today, including philosophers and scientists, no one is able to conclusively refute the existence of samsara, of psychic existence, of past and future lifetimes. So it's necessary, therefore, that we do make some preparation for existence beyond this one, and in fact, not.Applying energies to this is a very, very foolish and benighted approach.
我们现在看到的是我们的这个整个的人的轮回当中的一个很小很小的一个阶段。那么过去的我们看不见，未来的我们也看不见，我们只能看到看到眼前的这一点。那么很多人就认为轮回就是眼前的这一点那么他也不相信过去，不相信未来的这个存在但是呢，他也没有办法去否定过去和未来的存在，但是他就认为没有过去没有未来，只有现在就是这种因为这样子的这个人生观。就导致了我们的生活当中就导致了很多很多的问题。
There are many people who, based on not being able to see or have first-hand experience of the past or past lives or by the same token future lives, only regardthis existence or psychic existence as being that which we experience and know right now.
那么我们为什么看不到这个轮回的过去和轮回的未来？我们能看到的为什么只是中间的一个阶段呢？就是因为我们还没有超越轮回，也就是说我们的这个智慧还在这个轮回当中，还没有超越轮回，所以我们看不到它的边缘。
But the reason that we are not able to see beyond this current present existence to apprehend the entirety of cyclic existence is because our wisdom so far has not been able to transcend our current vantage point.
就像我们人在地球上的时候呢，我们只能在往前可以看到，前面可以看到10公里往后也就只能看到10公里，然后10公里以外的很多东西，我们平时都是看不见的。 有一天，如果我们超越了这个轮回啊，从月球上，从外太空啊，有机会看这个地球的话，那么这个时候呢，我们才能够看到这个地球的全景图啊，地球的真相。那个时候我们才能够看得到。
The limitedness or the constrained nature of our field of perception is like, us standing on the earth, being only able to see 10 kilometers in one direction and 10 kilometers in another direction. If one day we were able to stand on the moon or be in space and look on, down on the earth, we would be able to perceive it in all its entirety. And this is, exactly how transcending our limited perception of cyclic existence would also work.
在现实生活当中，我们就是为了我们的未来啊，做很多准备啊，买各种各样的保险啊，那就是因为我们害怕到时候啊会有这个意外，会有问题，所以我们买各种各样的保险。但是呢，死了以后，人死了以后呢，我们虽然没办法去确定啊。这个没办法去否定它的存在，但是呢，我们不做任何的事情啊，不买任何的保险啊，不做任何事情，不做任何准备啊，这就是一个非常愚昧的事情。
In everyday life, many people do make preparations for their future. They take out all kinds of insurance, for example, based on worries and concerns about what might happen to them in the future.However, given the fact that we are not able to refute the, fact of future existence or the ongoing nature of cyclic existence, then not making preparations for this event is extremely short-sighted and foolish.
好，那么接下来我们就讲啊，今天的这个主题的课。那么今天的我们主题的这个课呢，就是讲啊，三个主要道里面的空性。
We're going to move on now to the main topic of tonight's teaching, which is, the three principal aspects of the path, the correct view of emptiness.
出离心跟菩提心，我们昨天和前天简单的这个介绍了。今天呢，我们再给大家介绍一下这个空心空心这两个字，佛经里面经常都提到。我们可能在座的所有人都知道佛经里面就有这样子的这个词但是呢，我们很多人也不知道它的真正的意义是什么，所以我们有必要给大家介绍一下这个空心。
On the previous two nights, we have talked about renunciation and bodhicitta. Tonight, we're going to talk about emptiness. This is a term that is very frequently talked about in the Buddhist sutras and in the Buddhist teachings. However, not everyone may have a completely thorough idea of what this means. So that's what we're going to talk about this evening.
首先，我们给大家简单的说一下我们有机会学习空心这个就是对我们来说意味着什么。
First of all, we need to really ask what the fact that we have the chance to engage in the study of emptiness, what does this mean?
也就是说，我们听到了这个空心的话，那这个有什么样的功德？这个我们首先给大家简单的介绍一下。
Or putting it another way, what is the merit that we gain from listening and studying emptiness?
那么我们可以用一个比喻来说明这个问题。
We can use an analogy to elucidate this question.
这个比喻呢，不是我讲的，是释迦牟尼佛在《般若波罗蜜多经》佛经当中讲的一个比喻。
This analogy is not my own. It was, in fact, the Buddha's analogy in the Prajnaparamita Sutra.
那般若波罗蜜多般若舍松我们很多人都知道这个般若舍松，般若舍松这个是释迦牟尼佛亲口讲的。一个般若波罗蜜多经。
And the Prajnaparamita Sutra that I'm going to talk about is one that was spoken by the Buddha himself.
那么这个《般若波罗蜜多经》里面讲什么呢？佛陀说，比如说一个人在一个原始森林当中迷路了那么迷路了以后呢，他走了很长很长时间的这个路一直都找不到路那么就在这个森林当中呢，走了很长很长的时间都找不到路，都找不到出去的路那么最后呢？他就在这个森林当中就遇到了几个放牧的牧童放牧的牧童。
放牧牧童。
这个。弱子。
嗯。
这个西吧。弱子。放牛的小孩。
哦、oh, less, less.
Yeah.
This story is about a person who was wandering in and was wandering in a forest, wandering for a long time and became lost. Wandered around for a very long time and was not able to find a path out of the forest. Finally, at the end of some time, this individual encountered some young shepherd or herding.
放牛的小孩是吧
yeah. Yeah.
那么他就在这个森林当中走了很长时间，最后遇到了几位这个放牛的小孩，这个是对他来说意味着什么呢？就是意味着他快要到这个森林的边缘因为他已经到了这个森林的边缘，他快要这个从森林当中走出去因为放牧的这些小孩呢，他不会到森林的这个最深最深的地方去放牧，一般都在这个森林的边缘上放牧放牛。那么这个人遇到了这些小孩的时候呢，这就是意味着他很快就要从这个原始森林当中出去了。
The fact that this person had encountered the children who were herding cattle was an indicator of the fact that he had reached the border or the boundary of the forest. The reason being that these children wouldn't be herding cattle in the depths of the forest. So it was obvious then that he had reached a point at the outer edges of the forest.
好，那么这个这里面有一个是迷路的人然后另外一个就是原始森林还有一个就是这个放牧的小孩，就这三个那么这三个是什么比喻呢？第一个在原始森林当中迷路的人，就是我们轮回当中迷路的这些众生，就是包括我们叫做这个就是这个迷路的人，就是这个比喻。
So what is this analogy saying? Well, first of all, we have these three components. We have the lost person, we have the forest, and we have the children herding cattle. In this analogy, the person who is lost is a metaphor for us, beings wandering in cyclic existence.
然后这三个当中的原始森林是什么的比喻呢？原始森林就是我们的轮回就是物事物中的这个轮回就像一个原始森林一样这个森林是轮回的比喻。
And this virgin forest that the lost person is wandering around in is a metaphor for samsara, for cyclic existence.Which has been around since beginningless time.
然后第三个就是在这个森林的边缘上放牛的这些小孩呢是什么的比喻呢？就是我们现在听到的这个般若波罗蜜多空心的这个空心佛经就这些，比如说像金刚经这个般若心经等等就是。他们的比喻。
And the children herding their cattle, are a metaphor for the wisdom sutras.
那么这些佛经啊，这些佛经是就是说，比如说我们现在啊有机会去学习这些佛经啊，去学习这个空心啊，这就是对我们来说意味着我们很快就要从这个轮回当中啊获得解脱啊，我们很快就要在这个轮回当中可以啊走出去了啊，就是这个意思。
The fact that we have the opportunity to study these wisdom sutras is an indicator of the fact that we ourselves are very close to achieving liberation, that we are very near to being able to exit cyclic existence.
这是第一个啊，然后第二个呢，佛经里面就讲，比如说我们讲空心啊，学空心啊，然后呢，学习的过程当中，我们如果相信啊，或者是证悟空性啊，那就很快很快就要这个解脱了。虽然没有证悟啊，也不是非常非常的这个清楚，不太了解。但是呢，我们比如说啊，就是我在我们的心里就是有一个这样子的，比如说啊，可能是空心啊，有可能是空心啊，万事万物有可能是。空心有可能他还没有不确定他不是他也不确定是空心，如果是确定是空心，那这个功德已经是非常了不起的，但是呢还不太确定，但是他稍微比较稍微相信一点点，比如说有可能万事万物是空心的这样子的话，那么这个以这个功德，然后他的这个轮回就是受到了很大很大的破坏，所以他的轮回是再也没有办法继续下去的，也就是说我们不会很长时间就在这个轮回当中。
Well, clearly having a firm belief and realization in the emptiness of all phenomenon has the most inconceivable merit of all. Even a moderate beliefPerhaps not complete certitude or certainty, but a moderate belief that all phenomena could be empty in nature itself has great merit attached to it. And it has a very destructive impact on our cyclic existence, the fact that we are in samsara. Based on having even this modestknowledge or belief in the emptiness of all phenomena, we will not remain in cyclic existence for very much longer.
好，那么为什么是这样子呢？我们首先要知道我们今天为什么轮回啊？我们为什么一直都在这个轮回当中啊？这个一直都住在这个轮回当中啊？为什么它的动力是什么呢？首先我们要了解一下这个轮回的动力，我们一直都六转轮回，在轮回当中一直都六转走不出去，它的动力是什么呢？它的原动力是什么？
First of all, we need to understand why is it in fact that we are stuck in cyclic existence? What is the force? What is the force that keeps us here?
那么轮回的这个动力它的原动力，我们就在这个轮回当中一直都转，一直都转那么这样子的原因是什么呢？它的原动力从佛教的角度来讲的话，那么它佛教就告诉我们这个原动力，这个动力不在外面就在我们自己的心中，就是我们对这个世界，对我们自己的不了解的这个愚昧这个愚昧就是转这个就六转的原动力。
So in terms of gaining an understanding of what is this force that keeps us spinning in samsara, from the Buddhist point of view, this force is not located outside ourselves, it's not in the external world, but rather within our own minds. And this force is in fact our ignorance in relation to the world and its phenomena.
就像我们做梦的时候啊，在梦里面呢，我们为什么看到这么多的东西呢？为什么我们做梦呢？为什么梦里面有这么多的这个各种各样的现象呢？啊，很简单啊，我们为什么做梦？就是因为睡眠啊，人睡眠了就会做梦的。同样的，我们为什么这个轮回啊？我们为什么一直都在这个轮回当中啊？这个流转啊，不停。这个为什么呢？就是因为无明啊，因为有了无明，然后呢，我们就在这个轮回当中停不下来啊，一直都这个流转。
The reason why we experience dreams in which we experience and see so many things is because clearly that we are asleep. Being asleep, we have dreams. And it's the same with cyclic existence too. The fact that we experience, the fact that we are in samsara is due to our ignorance. And this is the propelling force that keeps us in this state.
那么我们怎么样去证明啊这个轮回的根源或者是它的原动力就是无明呢？啊，第一个，有释迦牟尼佛，还有除了佛以外，还有成千上万的修行人啊，大乘的、小乘的修行人，就是他们因为啊断除了啊破坏了、消灭了他们的这个无明，然后呢，他们从这个轮回当中获得了解脱，这就是充分的说明我们的这个轮回，我们轮回的这个动力、原动力，这是无明，这是第一个证啊，这是第一个证据。
So what is our evidence for the fact that ignorance is the propelling force of cyclic existence? Well, the first evidence is that the Buddha and after him, countless numbers, hundreds of thousands of practitioners and great masters have all succeeded in attaining liberation and in fact transcending cyclic existence by dispelling their own ignorance.
然后第二个呢，我们自己去学习修心打坐，最后我们证悟空性的时候呢，然后我们从这个轮回当中慢慢慢慢地获得解脱，这个时候呢，我们自己亲身感觉到啊，亲身感受到啊，原来我们这个六转轮回的原因啊，就是这个无明。因为没有这个无明的时候呢，我们现在就开始啊离开这个轮回啊，到时候呢啊，每个人都自己可以体会到，这是第二个证据。
And the second kind of evidence that we have available to ourselves is our own experience. Through our own study and practice of the Buddha's teachings, it will be similarly possible for us to dispel our ignorance and to transcend cyclic existence. So it is based on this that we have a second kind of evidence for the fact of ignorance being the propelling force of cyclic existence.
那么这个问题呢，我们也可以用一个比喻来说明这个问题。比如说抓老鼠的粘鼠板啊，大家都应该知道的啊，就是一块这个木板，然后上面就有胶水啊，然后呢就是老鼠就站在这个木板上，然后它就会死掉的。有一个这样子的工具叫做粘鼠板。
There's an analogy we can use to talk about this for the a kind of mouse trap, which is a piece of wood with a sticky patch on it, so that when the mouse runs onto the base, they get stuck on the sticky patch.
那么这个战术板啊是什么呢？就是我们的六道轮回。
And this mouse trap with a sticky patch is in fact the six realms of samsara.
就站在这个战术板上面撕掉的这个老鼠呢，就是我们六道轮回当中的众生。
And the mouse or the rat that dies after being stuck on this mouse trap is a metaphor for us, the beings in the six realms of cyclic existence.
那么 老鼠为什么站在这个粘鼠板上呢？就是因为有脚水啊，就是因为是脚水的这个作用。那么我们六道轮回的众生，为什么啊站在这个轮回当中啊脱离不了呢？像粘鼠板上面的脚水一样的东西是什么呢？啊，然后我们很多很多的宗教都有不同的说法，比如说上帝呀、啊。或者是其他的呀，各种各样都有。但是呢，佛教的观点是什么呢？就是我们自己的错误的观点，就像这个粘鼠板上的这个啊，这个脚水，就是因为我们有了一个这样子的错误的观念，把这个错误的观念把我们自己粘在这个轮回当中啊，最后就走不出去。
So the reason the mouse gets stuck in the mouse trap is because of the sticky patch. That's what causes the mouse to get stuck. What then is it that causes we as beings to get stuck in samsara? Well, that sticky substance from the point of view of the Buddhist teachings is our incorrect or distorted understanding of things, understanding of phenomena, and it'sThis that causes us to become enmeshed and stuck in samsara.
从另外一个角度来讲的话，从另外一个比喻来讲的话，这个我们的五明就像地心的引力啊，就像地心的引力，就因为我们的地球有这个地心的引力，有强大的引力，所以呢，月球啊就在这个地球的外面转，然后就比如月球、人造卫星等等等等，很多啊都在这个地球的这个周边转，最后呢，他们都会落到地球上，还是走不开的。为什么？就是因为这个地球有引力的原因。
Another analogy we can use is the force of gravity, which operates in the world and in so that all matter ultimately gravitate towards the earth.
那么我们的这个啊，就在这个轮回当中，一直都流转在轮回当中，走不出，脱离不了这个轮回的，像地心的引力这样子的力量是什么呢？这是我们自己的愚昧啊！这是我们自己的愚昧。用佛教的话来讲的话，这叫做无明。
So the fact that we are stuck in cyclic existence, that we are so trapped here, almost as if by a force as strong as gravity, is due to the fact that we are, from the point of view of the Buddhist teachings, ignorant.
那么我们现在啊，就是通过这个闻思修，最后要解决的问题是什么呢？就像这个啊，地球的引力，或者是粘鼠板上面的这个脚水这样子的东西啊，我们要把它消灭。消灭了以后呢，我们可以从这个轮回当中解脱。
So it's through the threefold process of listening, reflecting, and meditating that we seek to get rid of the sticky substance on the mouse trap or the force of gravity that keeps us enmeshed in samsara.
那么这个啊，无明我们怎么样去消灭呢？啊，无明的对立的啊，对立跟无明对立的东西是智慧啊，智慧。所以我们要解决这个无明，要消灭无明的话，那就是不是烧香拜佛来解决这个问题，也不是求佛临时抱佛教这样子的方式来解决这个问题，而是长期的一个学习修心打坐，在这个过程当中获得的一种智慧，去推翻这个无明。
In terms of how we go about dispelling our ignorance, the antidote that we need is wisdom. And this is wisdom that we can attain through listening, reflecting, and meditating on the Buddhist teachings. It's not something that we will be able to derive from simply making offerings to the Buddha and things like this.
那么这个智慧啊，这个智慧跟无明是对立的、矛盾的啊。那么 我们现在啊，现在我们当我们是一个普通的人的时候呢，我们的这个智慧啊，几乎我们没有什么这方面的智慧，所以我们的这个无明是非常非常强大啊。那这个时候呢，我们只能在这个轮回当中流转，不能脱离轮回。
Wisdom and ignorance are forces opposed to each other. But the reason that we still remain in cyclic existence is that as ordinary beings, for the time being, our wisdom is only very, very small in nature. In fact, we don't have much wisdom really to speak of.
那么现在我们啊，通过学习，空心啊，然后呢？通过修心来培养我们的这个智慧啊，培养智慧，然后这个智慧呢，从无到有啊，从有到逐渐的增长啊，这样以后呢，当我们的这个智慧强大的时候呢，哦，这个无明呢就会慢慢的会减少啊，这样子我们的轮回就开始。它的原动力就开始受到了这个破坏，也就是说，我们从这个轮回当中开始解脱。
So it's through the study and practice on emptiness, and through the cultivation of wisdom, that we will be able to transform ourselves from a state of not having wisdom to a state of possessing wisdom, and beyond that.To a situation where we are constantly growing in our wisdom. When this happens, our ignorance will accordingly grow smaller in nature.
那么佛经啊，佛经或者是释迦牟尼佛认为我们啊，就是拥有啊这样子的这个人生啊，可以学习空性的人。是真的是非常非常幸福的，虽然这个轮回当中啊是很苦的，但是呢，在这个轮回当中拥有这样子的机会的人啊是非常幸福的。
Even though cyclic existence is characterized by suffering, from the point of view of the Buddha, the fact that we have the opportunity to study emptiness in this lifetime is something very, very fortunate indeed.
我们凡夫啊，我们普通的人实际上是非常非常可怜的啊。为什么呢？我们所谓的这个享受啊，所谓的享受幸福快乐，我们自动的享受，通过感官的刺激。所获得的啊这些感受，除了这个感受以外，这个世界上还有很多很多非常非常美妙的啊这个感受，就像真无空性呢等等的美妙的这个感受。那么这些感受呢，我们根本就不懂得啊享受，所以呢，我们一般的没有学习的这没有学习空性的机会的啊这样大部分的人。其实实际上就是很可怜的，包括我们自己。
Most people, including ourselves, are really quite pitiable. In general, our understanding or our definition of happiness really relies on things like the stimulation of our senses. This is how we really understand pleasure and happiness. In actual fact, there are all manner of other kinds of pleasures that are available to us of a very different kind of nature. For example, realizing the nature of emptiness. In general, however, this is not something that most people have the opportunity to study and neither the opportunity to appreciate the wonderful nature of this.
所以物质啊，对我们来说啊，对我们的生存来说，确实是很重要的，啊，很重要的。但是呢，除了物质以外呢，我们必须要知道，还有很多很多的非常美妙的东西，啊，非常美好的东西，我们可以去追求。所以从这个角度来讲，人生啊，就有很多很多的追求，很多很多的选择。所以人生啊，是非常难得的。
While material things, of course, have their importance, we need to understand that there are, in fact, so many other marvelous, beautiful things that we have available to us or experiences.
好，接下来我们啊，给大家简单的介绍一下这个什么叫做空心啊，因为我们今天这个在座的当中，可能是我们的层次不齐。可能一部分人呢可能是学过空心，对空心稍微有一些了解啊，那么一部分人呢可能是刚刚学佛啊，也许学佛不是刚刚，已经学了很长很长时间，但是实际上我们的所谓的学佛有可能停留在这个烧香拜佛的这个阶段当中，已经十年二十年过去了，其实没有真正的学到佛，那有可能一部分人是这样子，所以我们的层次不齐啊，在这样子的这个时候啊，就给大家讲空心呢，就是不是很合理的啊，因为我们的层次不齐，所以讲了可能是没有太多的啊这个用。但是呢，我们还是要啊给大家啊简单的介绍一下什么叫做空心。
So we're going to move on to talking briefly about what we mean by emptiness. Among everyone who has come here tonight, there are probably people at different levels of understanding, people who have studied emptiness before and people who have not. There may be people who have been Buddhists for maybe 10 or even 20 years,but have not ever really had the opportunity to learn about emptiness. Teaching about emptiness at this point may not be of great use to such students, given their level of preparation. But in any case, we're going to talk briefly tonight about what we mean by emptiness.
那么首先啊，我们要知道什么叫做空心呢？简单的说啊，用一句话来说空心的话，空心就是说我们看到的，我们听到的，我们接触到的，就是我们的这个感官的世界当中所接触到的这些东西，也就是万事万物都是虚拟的，不是一个真实的东西这个叫做空心。简单的说，这叫做空心。
So emptiness, putting it simply, we can say is the fact that all that we perceive with our senses, whether it be our eyes, our ears, etc., is in fact not intrinsically real or existent. It is illusory in nature.
那么这句话我们第一次看到的时候呢，第一次听到的时候呢，我们的第一个反应是什么呢？我想可能很多人都不能理解了，很多人觉得怎么可能呢？我们的现实生活当中的一切就这么的真实这么真实的东西怎么能够说他们是虚拟的、虚幻的呢？这根本就不可能我们很多大部分人的这个反应是这样子的。
It's possible that the majority of people, the first time they hear this statement, may feel a sense of incredulity. They might think, how can it be that everything in our worlds, in our life, is illusory in nature? Everything is so plainly existent.
那么少部分的很少很少一部分的这个人的反应是什么呢？一听到了这个空心这样子的这个内容的时候呢，然后非常的激动非常的激动就是非常的感动有些人是由眼泪直流，热泪盈眶，汗毛竖立也有这样子的这个情况。
But there will be a small number of people upon hearing that the nature of everything isessentially empty, will be extremely moved, by this statement, such that they may even shed tears or the hairs on their body may stand up.
那么一听到了这个空心的时候，就是非常激动的这种人呢，这就是说明他对这个空心呢，过去 也就是他的上一世、再上一世对这个空心是有所了结啊，他曾经学过，甚至是他曾经啊证悟过。但是呢，在这个中间呢，因为其他的种种的原因啊，就是没有继续的修，就是忘掉了一段时间啊，忘掉一段时间。那么这种人呢啊，现在啊稍微投入一点这样子的话，那就是非常有希望，一定会很快就会证悟空心的，这叫做悔根啊，悔根成熟。
People who have a strong reaction upon hearing about emptiness have obviously plainly had a understanding of emptiness, or perhaps even a realization of emptiness in past lifetimes. It may have been that this realization wasn't abiding, or that they forgot about this realization for a period of time. But in any case, such individuals, by applying some diligence to their practice in this lifetime, will rapidly be able to make good results.
那么我们大部分的人的这个反应啊，大家都觉得怎么可能呢？或者是很疑惑啊，怎么可能这么真实的东西不存在呢？啊，这个就是我们对于我们普通人来说是一个正常的反应。
But the response of the majority of people that the illusory of nature of things being hard to believe, almost confusing, a bit ridiculous, this is of course a normal response.
那么这个时候首先我们要问自己啊，那么我们刚才说啊，因为这么真实的东西啊，这么真实的世界怎么可能不存在呢？啊，我们的反应是这样子。那么首先我们要去思考一下啊，这么真实的世界啊，谁告诉我这个世界是这么真实的呢？这个我们继续要去思考这个问题。
But in terms of the our feeling that the world is so real appearing, what we need to do is investigate further. Who was it, or who is it that has taught us about the reality of the world that we take so for granted?
那么谁告诉我们这个世界是很真实的呢？当然啊，不是外人告诉我们，是我们的感官啊告诉我们这个是很真实的。就像我们的视觉啊告诉我们，我们看到的这些东西是很真实的啊。然后我们的听觉告诉我们，我们听到的任何一个声音都是很真实的。然后我们的触觉啊告诉我们，我们接触到的这一切都是很真实的。啊，总而言之，就是我们的这些感官啊告诉我们这个世界是真实的。
So in terms of our belief in the intrinsic reality, the true existence of our worlds, it certainly wasn't aliens who told us this was the case. It is in fact our own sense organs, our eyes, our sense of sight, our ears, our sense of sound, our sense of touch, all of these things that we regard as being infallible and true, it is these that have told us about, or that we have relied on in terms of our conclusion that the world is true.
另外一个告诉我们这个世界是很真实的是谁呢？就是我们的意识啊，我们的意识，除了我们的感官的感知以外，就是力值啊，就是我们的意识。那么我们的意识就告诉我们啊，这个世界当然是真实的呀，是我自己亲眼看到的呀，是我自己亲耳听到的呀，我亲眼看到的、亲耳听到的，这些都是真实的啊。这样子，他就判断这个世界是真实的，然后他告诉我们啊，这个世界是真实啊。那么这个是第二个，就是我们的意识。
The other source of our belief in the true existence of the world around us is our own minds who tell us that the world is true, what we see is true, that everything is true. The second source of our belief in the true existence of things is our own mind.
那么这两个，第一个就是感知，我们的感官的这个很直接的觉受啊，这个感官的这个觉受告诉我们是真实的。第二个是我们的意识去判断这个是真实。那么这两个它有多大的可信度呢？我们可不可以完全相信它们呢？我们接下来就是要思考这个问题。
So these two things, the first being our sense perceptions and the second being our own minds, these two things that have told us or that we rely on in terms of our belief that the world is true, what we need to do is examine the extent to which these two sources of our belief are true, the extent to which they can be believed in.
那么我们的意识我们的意识可以去分析判断思考这些都它有这样子的这个功能那么但是呢它的这个判断它最后的判断呢它依靠什么呢它的依据是什么呢它的依据就是我们的感官感官传递给它的一个信息比如说我们的视觉告诉他我们前面的这束花里面有红色的有白色的然后就是有这个有绿色的叶子有这样子的这个颜色这个我们的视觉发现了以后呢把这个信息传递给他以后我们的意识就判断这束花的颜色是白色红色等等他是这样子判断的。
So our minds have the ability to analyze, to evaluate, to consider and reflect. However, ultimately, the basis on which our minds engage in these functions is the data that our minds receive from our sense perceptions. So for example, our eyes, our visual sense organs will transmit to our mind information about a flower, the color of its petals, red or white, its leaves, etc. And it's on this basis, the basis of this transmitted data, that our minds will engage in their evaluative work.
所以它的所有的这个判断的依据都是感官感官如果感官有错的话那他一定会错的如果感官传递给他的信息是错误的信息的话那么他的判断一定会是错误的所以他自己没有太多的独立的这个判断的能力他要靠这个感官给他的这个信息他把感官传递给他的信息分析以后呢他就去确定这个是红色这个是白色这样子的结论他自己没有一个独立的这样子的这个依据他就是要依靠感官所以感官的这个信息有错那他一定会错的
Our minds don't have an independent ability of their own to discover the nature of things. They are completely reliant on the information that is provided to them through our senses. If for any reason our senses provide our minds with mistaken or distorted data, then the evaluations our minds will make will be distorted and mistaken themselves.
那么我们的感官给它传递的这个信息呢大部分都是错误的大部分都是错误的。这个我们很就已经现代科学已经很多问题都已经证明这个是我们的感官的这些信息都是错误的。比如说我们现在看到的这束花是红色的是黄色的是白色的。那么我们一直都认为这个红黄白是这束花它的颜色我们一直都认为这个物质就有这样子的颜色。
In actual fact, most of the data that our senses are feeding our minds is mistaken or distorted. However, this is something that scientific research is able to corroborate. For example, we are accustomed to believing that the colors we see, we perceive in a flower, red, yellow, white, etc., are intrinsically existing, that they objectively exist as color categories.
在现实生活当中，如果有人告诉我们啊，这束花的花的红色、黄色、白色啊，这个颜色是不存在的啊，不存在的，这束花是没有颜色的啊。如果有人这么告诉我们，我们就是没有办法理解啊。我们一直都认为花有颜色啊，我们一定会说怎么没有颜色啊？我明明看到它是黄色呀，是红色呀。怎么可能没有颜色呢？我们一定会这样子反驳。
If someone were to say to us that the colors we see in the flower, the red, the yellow, and the white, are not true, we would have a very difficult time believing them. We would say, plainly, I can see with my own eyes that this is red, or this is white, or this is yellow.
所以我们的感官也就确定这个鲜花是有颜色的。然后呢，根据这个感官的信息，我们的医师也就已经确定了，坚定不移的相信啊，这朵花的颜色是红色，是黄色，是这个白色啊。这个我们的感官和医师他们两个啊，都毫无疑问的就确定了啊，现实生活当中有这些颜色的。
So after our sense perception, our eyes have sent the message that we are perceiving red to our minds. Our minds draw a very fixed conclusion that we are seeing the color red. This is something that our sense perception and our minds are in complete concordance on.
但是啊，现代科学告诉我们，这个跟佛经讲的完全是一样的啊。我并不是说我们佛教里面讲的所有的都要用现代科学来证明印证，也并不是说我们佛教讲的所有的东西都能够以现代科技来这个印证，这个是不可能的。但是呢，很多问题上面呢，啊，这个佛教讲的这些很多很多观点都。以这个现代的高科技印证了啊，那么现代科学告诉我们，这束花是没有颜色的。这个花啊，那么没有颜色，这红的、黄的，我明明看到，这是什么东西呢？啊，他告诉我们，这是你自己的大脑里面的一个图像而已。
However, in terms of the colors that we are perceiving, both the Buddhist teachings and, in fact, contemporary science tell us that all we are seeing is an imaginary perception of our own senses and mind. In saying that scientific findings corroborate the Buddhist teachings, I'm not saying that in fact that everything in the Buddhist tradition is necessarily can be corroborated by science. However, it is certainly the case that there is common findings and common conclusions on this point.
佛教里面讲的空心啊不好理解啊，对我们初学者来说不好理解啊。但是呢，如果我们能够接受啊，我们现在看到这束花。是没有颜色的，这些所有的颜色是我自己的大脑里面的产生的一种图像啊。实际上，外面的物质，这束鲜花，它是没有颜色，它不是红色，它不是白色啊。如果我们能够接受这个观点的话，那么这个跟空心也是很接近的。空心我们也可以接受了啊，我们也可以慢慢的理解了。
Understanding the nature of emptiness or the meaning of emptiness is something that's difficult, it's something that's complex. However, if we're able to accept that What we are perceiving in terms of the color of a flower is just but an image in our own minds, then we are coming to a very close approximation of what we mean by emptiness. And this is something that we can continue to develop our understanding in respect of.
那么这个真的是非常有意思的啊！大家要好好想一想，这个是科学。我们比如说某一个宗教、某一个哲学啊的这个结论，我们如果我自己不想接受的话，我们可以说我不相信啊，我可以说我不相信啊。但是科学告诉我们的这些事实啊，这个就是事实啊，这个我们不能说我不相信啊，我们。能够理解啊，能不能理解呢？那是另外一回事啊。但是呢，你想推翻它，这个是没有办法推翻，这是事实啊。那么事实告诉我们，这个红色的花不是红色的花，它没有颜色啊。那么这个我们真的不好理解了。如果这个能够理解，那空心也是可以理解的。
So this is something that's really amazing. It's something that we really need to think about. Of course, it's possible for us for in terms of a religious view, argument or a philosophical argument for us to just say plainly we don't believe in it. However, if something is proved as a fact, as a scientific fact, then it's very difficult for us to say that we don't believe in it or to find some way of overturning the reasonable of this, the reasonableness of this assertion. So this is something that's very compelling.
那么科学家的理由是什么呢？我们所谓的我们眼睛看到这个光，看到东西啊，是一个什么样的理由呢？是什么原理呢？光啊，就照射在我们所看到的这个物体上面。然后呢，这个光的反射啊，就是这个光进入了我们的眼睛的视网膜，然后呢，我们的眼睛就看到这个东西啊，这个就是一般的，我们看东西都是这样子。
The scientific explanation of sight is, or the visual perception is when light reflects on an object, and this is then perceived in our eye and produces an image.
那么这个时候呢，光啊，它从这个光啊，从比如说光照射在这个这束花，然后呢，从这束花上面的这个光的反射啊，进入我们的这个视网膜。那这时候的这个光所进入我们的视网膜的这个光，它是有没有颜色？它是没有颜色的光啊。也是一种薄的心识啊，它就是从一个薄的心识穿过来。那么穿底的时候呢，这个薄除了极光以外的这个光都是有这个它的薄长啊，有长有短。比如说薄啊，就是像这样子的方式来叫做长薄，然后以这样子的方式啊传播的叫做短薄。那么薄有长和短，那么。长薄和短薄啊的原因啊，然后呢，我们的这个视网膜里面呢，就产生了一种啊，实际上不存在的一种效果，这个就叫做颜色。
In terms of understanding color, the light that reflects on an object and then which is reflected into the retina of our eyes is in itself colorless.In fact, what it's characterized by are frequencies, light frequencies, that vary in terms of their shortness and length. And it's based on these that we experience in our own minds a perception of color.
那么这个光的波，它实际上就是一种电磁波的一种啊，电磁波、光波，它是没有颜色的啊，它没有颜色的。它没有颜色，但是这个波由长又短的波进入了我们的视网膜的时候呢，在我们的大脑里面呢，就产生的就是这些图像。光它自己是没有颜色的。
So this light in itself is not devoid of color. It is colorless. It is only its its waves, its light waves, which vary in terms of their lengths of frequency when they enter our eye, which produce the illusion of color.
那么这个问题就说明了很大很大的问题了，就是解决了很大的问题了。我们一定要仔细的去、认真的去思考一下。我们一直从小到大一直都认为这个颜色，各种各样的颜色，就是外面的物质的颜色，物质是有颜色的，我们认为颜色就是存在的东西啊，就在这个物质世界里面呢有颜色的存在啊。但是呢，现在我们不能不承认，这个物质世界里面呢没有所谓的颜色，颜色都是在我自己的大脑里面，红色、黄色都在我自己大脑里面，不在这个物质上啊。那么这个时候呢，我们看到的这些为什么有颜色呢？那就是因为我们自己的大脑里面有这样子的图像啊，然后我们以为外面的啊物质有颜色，其实不是外面的物质有颜色，是我们大脑里面的一个图像啊。那么这个就是说明，这就是推翻了我们啊对这个物质的颜色的执着，已经推翻了。
This example of color and our perception of color is highly illustrative. For our entire existences, we have been entirely confident in our belief that color existed objectively in the external world around us. So color objectively exists in objects, in flowers, in the natural environment, etc., and not in... and not as an illusion of our own minds. However, we understand now that this is not the case, that there are in fact no objective colors in the outside world, and the colors that we perceive are in fact perceptions that our own minds, our brains have manufactured.
好，还有一个呢，啊，还有一个很有意思的，就是说声音，啊，我们的视听觉听到的这个声音啊，那么我们也要去思考一下，它到底存在和不存在啊？就是比如说，在一个原始森林里面啊，就是周边没有任何人，没有任何的动物啊。假设就有一个这样子的原始森林啊，它的周边几十公里里面呢，没有人，没有这个其他的动物啊。没有任何的这个动物。那么在这样子的这个原始森林当中啊，把一棵很老很老很高很高的树倒下去的话啊，倒下去的话，那么这个有没有声音呢？啊，大家觉得这个有没有声音啊？我们两个师兄回答一下，谁回答都可以。你说有声音还是没有声音呢？啊，我把再清说得清楚一点啊。就在这个一个原始森林啊，周边十几几十公里当中啊，不，实际上是不可能有一个这样子的世界啊。假设周边十几啊，周边的这个几十公里当中啊，没有任何人，没有任何的动物啊，在一个这样子的原始森林当中，一棵很高很高很高的树倒下去的话啊，那么它有没有声音啊？它有没有声音？有还是没有？没有。有没有声音？大家看看。
听得到。哎呦。
啊。好好好。好。好，我如果我们啊要说，如果说没有声音的话呢，也要讲没有声音的理由。如果说有声音的话呢，也要讲有声音的理由。好，还要再来一个啊，另外一个师兄再回答一下。好，等一下。好，再来一个，另外一个，有声音还是没有声音呢？啊，没有声音是吧？好，请你站起来啊，就是给我们讲述一下为什么没有声音。没有人就没有声音吗？但是没有人听见，是没有人听得见呢，但是呢声音还是有吧。没有人听得见就 哦，那么比如说一个蜂蜜啊，没有人吃它就没有这个甜味吗？不会吧？不对，不对，这个逻辑不对。好，你来解释一下，为什么没有声音呢？
声音是我们的脑子的感觉，看到的东西是我们脑子的感觉，我们没在那个地方，怎么听得到的那个声音呢？是如果没有人，没有那个脑子 ，no mind， you won't hear nothing。
声音是我们脑子里面的感觉。
声音是我们耳朵里面的那个our perceptions in our ear sensory organs that develop into our mind。
声音如果是我们自己的脑子里的感觉的话，那为什么我说话的时候你才能够听得见，我不说话的时候听不见呢？
你不说话的时候我没想到你啊。
哦，不，这根本不是像不像的问题了。
就是也是一样，就是我的脑子没有更
好。好，还有两位师兄，好，最后一个啊，好，不要太多了，再最后一个可以回答一下。好，
其实我这个是帮我太太，
帮你太太回答，好也好，更好。
这个让我说。
好。
他说这个有声音还是没声音，取决于你自己的认为。
啊，这个就是禅宗里面的心的这个幡动和风动都不是，实际上心动就这个意思。啊，这个都不是科学了啊啊！好，还有最后一个，好，最后一个啊，好，其他师兄不回答了。好，这个就比较接近真理了。好，接下来我们再看一下，那么一个这样子的原始森林当中，为什么？雕塑倒下去了以后没有声音呢？其实在几百年前这个西方的英国禁烟唯心论的这个贝克莱他说过这个森林里面的树倒下去了以后呢没有声音的但是呢他是没有什么理由，他想证明万法就是唯心，当然不是我们佛教这样的唯心啊，唯心主义的唯心，他想证明这个。当时他说过，当时他没有什么理由。呀、
yeah. ，So just as by examining our perception of color, we're able to overturn our assumption or our belief in the objective existence of color in the external environment.We can also turn our minds to the question of sound and the objective existence of sound. For example, in an extremely pristine, silent forest, a forest in which there are no humans and no animals for a radius of several tens or scores of kilometers, if a extremely tall tree were to fall down, would it make a sound? Would the tree falling down produce a sound?This is a question that we can productively contemplate. And Kenpo asked members of the audience to offer their opinions as to whether or not the tree falling down would produce a sound. And the most of the responses, people who responded felt that whether or not there were a sound would depend on the existence of a perceiver of that sound. And without a human there present in order to hear the tree falling down, then there would not be a sound to speak of. The final respondent suggested that there would be some kind of waves produced as a result of the tree falling down. But in terms of categorizing this as sound or not is a human construction or designation that would be imposed on the existence of mere waves. About 100 years ago, there was an English philosopher who commented on this very example. His response was that the tree falling down produced no sound.
好，实际上就是没有声音的，没有声音，那么这个书倒下去了以后呢，它就在这个空气当中就产生了一个压力波啊，压力波，但是这个压力波周边没有任何的动物，所以呢这个压力波只能在这个空气当中自生自灭啊，没有人，没有产生啊，没有产生声音，那么如果在这个周边有一个人的话，那么这个声音，空气当中的这个压力波通过空气传播，传播了以后最后传到我们的这个耳朵里面，然后震动了我们的耳膜啊，这完全是一个物质上的一个解释啊。然后呢真正的声音呢啊，这是我们自己的一种感受啊，就在我们大脑里面呢啊，出现了一种什么就叫做声音的一个这样子的感受，所以声音就是我们自己的大脑里面的一种感受啊。科学家讲的大脑里面的图像，实际上啊是什么呢？就是我们自己的一种感受啊。用佛教的话来讲，声音是我们的自己的感受啊。那么我们一直都认为声音是外在的东西，外在的物质，那么现在就是啊，这个就被否定了，声音不是外，声音是不存在的，是我们自己的感受。
If the tree falling down without the presence of any animals or any humans in the vicinity would produce some waves of pressure. However, with the no one or no animal or human to receive or perceive these waves, they would essentially take place and dissipate in the air itself. However, if there were in fact someone to perceive these pressure waves,In fact, this information were to be received by a human ear, then it would produce the mental perception of sound. So sound is, in fact, as with visual objects, ultimately a construction or a mental image that takes place at the level of mind and is not something that objectively exists in the external world outside of ourselves.
那么既然声音是我们自己的感受的话，那么我们想听音乐到音乐厅里面去花钱啊，这个卖什么呢啊，实际上我们不是买到这个音乐的声音，我们只是买一个空气压力波啊，实际上声音就是我们自己的大脑里面的感受。
Since sound is in fact really just a perception that we have, when we go to a music store and pay money to listen to music, in fact what we're not paying for music, we're not paying for a sound. Essentially what we're paying for are sound waves.
然后眼色啊，也就不是物质的眼色，不存在。啊，就是我们自己的眼啊，自己大脑里面的感受。那么这样子的话，比如说我们买衣服啊，买家具，买其他的这些日常用品啊，就是因为这个颜色，我们非常非常的挑剔啊，就是为了喜欢找到一个自己喜欢的颜色，然后愿意多花钱啊，等等付出很多。但是实际上这些呢啊。其实都不是外面的，就是自我们自己的大脑里面的感受啊。那么这两个问题呢，我觉得这个里面就有我们深入的去思考的话，那就有很多很多可以思考的东西。
And with color, for example, we're often extremely choosy when it comes to material objects. We will spend a lot of money, for example, on acquiring something that is a color that we like.But in actual fact, color doesn't reside in the object itself. It is a perception that's produced in our own minds. So by really turning our minds to these two questions, the question of color and the question of sound, we can draw very productive conclusions.
那么这样子的话，我们现在知道啊，我们的感官就没有什么可信度了。它一直都告诉我们，声音是外面。啊，这个物质世界当中存在的，然后颜色也是存在，我们一直都从小到现在一直都这么认为。 那么现在我们就知道颜色也原来就是不是无知，无知没有颜色，然后声音呢，所谓的声音好听的不好听的等等，其实根本就外面没有什么所谓的这个声音，只有一个空气压力波，其实这个颜色都是自己的大脑里面的感受，然后呢声音也是我自己的感受，除了我自己的感受以外外面没有这样子的东西啊。这个时候呢，那么我们就没有，从此以后就再也没有办法去相信啊我们的感官。
What contemplating these two examples does teach us is that our senses are profoundly unreliable. All of our lives they have been telling us, they've been teaching us that qualities and characteristics objectively exist in the outside world around us in external objects, whether it be color or whether it be sound.However, we now know that this is not the case, whether music, in fact, is pleasant sounding or not pleasant sounding, or whether a color is appealing or not, is not something that rests in the objective qualities of an outside object, but rather is a perception that's manufactured at the level of our own minds.
那么这个时候呢，我们再也不敢说啊，这个世界当然是真实的呀，因为我明明看到了呀，因为我的感官接触了，我看到的呀，我听到的呀，所以它是真实的呀。啊，这个话这样子的话没有什么说服力了啊。从此以后，我们感觉到这个没有什么说服力。
So realizing this from now on, we can no longer say that.The world around me is intrinsically real because this is what my senses tell me. We have entirely debunked this mode of reasoning, so we can no longer hold to this.
那么这个时候我们怎么理解这个空心呢？啊，从我们的感官的角度啊，感官的角度来讲，这一切都是很真实的啊。善有善报，恶有恶报，善恶因果啊，还有我们的现实生活啊，还有我们在现实生活当中的这个所感觉到的一切的这个感受啊，痛苦、幸福等等，所有的一切啊，从我们的感官的角度来讲，都是真实的。从这个角度来讲，我们永远都不会说它是虚幻的，它是不存在的，它是空心的。啊，不会这么说的。这个从这个角度来讲，都是真实的。
Of course, this is something that we have to understand on two levels. Certainly, at the at the level of our senses, from the point of view of our sense perception, everything in our world, yes, does seem as real. Our life experiences, notions of good, evil.Karmic cause and effect, etc. These are all things that, at the level of our senses, do exist as real. And from this, at this level, at any rate, we would not claim them to be empty or illusory in nature.
从我们的感官的角度来讲啊，钢琴是有声音的，鲜花是有颜色的，毫无疑问的可以回答啊，没有人否定。
At the level of our senses, we can surely say that a piano produces sound and that flowers have color. This is not something that anybody would refute.
但是呢，另外一个角度来讲，钢琴是没有声音的，鲜花是没有没有颜色的啊。从另外一个角度来讲，没有颜色。所以这个时候呢，我们以为钢琴发出了它的各种各样的声音啊，这个声音是来自于它，声音是存在的。然后我们看到的这个鲜花的这个颜色啊，我们一直都以为它是物质的颜色，物质是有颜色啊。这两个观点啊，这个时候呢，我们就知道这个是错误的，这是不对的啊。这是我们自己的一种幻觉，所谓的大脑里面的啊，这个图像就是幻觉啊。从这个角度来讲，都是不真实的。
But from another perspective, at another level, we can see that in actual fact, it is not possible to say that a piano makes a sound or that flowers have color.From another level, we are very clear, in fact, that the notion that a piano has sound or that flowers have color is an illusion that is produced in our minds and is not a fact of these objects intrinsically.
然后我们啊，在这个传统上佛教里面常用的一个比喻，就是我们做梦的时候的这个梦境啊。从做梦的人的角度来讲啊，梦里面的一切都是非常非常的真实的，跟我们的现实生活没有什么区别。所以，做梦的人的角度讲啊，梦就是真实的。
Another analogy that we like to talk about in the Buddhist teachings is that of a dream. From the point of view of the dreamer, everything that is taking place in the dreamscape seems as very real.
但是从现实生活的角度，或者是从熟悉的人的角度来讲的话，那么梦里面他看到的一切啊都是不存在，一切都是假的，一切都是虚幻的。
However, from the point of view of an awake person, everything inside the dream is absolutely not real. It's illusory, it's imagined.
那么从梦做梦的人的角度讲，梦就是真实啊，跟现实生活完全一样。那么熟悉的人的角度来讲，根本就是不存在的。那么这两个当这两个是矛盾啊，一个是存在，一个不存在。那么这两个当中啊，那一个是真实的呢？那我们会说啊，这个熟悉的人啊，从现实生活的角度讲的啊，这个是对的啊。梦里面呢，他是因为做梦，因为幻觉，因为他的错误的幻觉导致的一个世界，不是一个真实的世界。真实的世界呢，就是我们的这个现实生活，我们大家都会这么说。
So there's clearly a conflict between the dreamer who perceives everything in the dream as real and the awake person who sees everything in the dream as simply an illusion. If we were to ask ourselves, however, who is correct, the dreamer or the awake person, then we would answer it is the awake person. From the point of view of the awake, the dream is entirely an illusion of the mind.
所以我们把这两个要分开啊，在现实生活当中，我们的感官的角度，我们的感官也就是没有被提升的时候，就像我们现在的这个自然的感官，从这个角度来讲，这个物质世界也好，精神世界也好，啊，因果善恶因果都是存在的。这个时候我们不讲空啊，这个时候我们只讲因果。不讲空啊，善有善报，恶有恶报，所以我们一定要这个善恶的取舍方面啊，我们一定要这个要做好啊，要这个要做好，否则的话，我们不能说啊，一切都是空性，无所谓啊，善也不存在，恶也不存在，这样子的话，那么这一切都会乱套的。所以从这个角度来讲，我们要遵守这个因果啊，从这个角度，我们不会讲空心的。
Of course, it is necessary until we've reached a point where our senses are in fact elevated in their nature to respect the order of things that our senses tell us. So in particular, the law of cause and effect, good, evil. In fact, if we didn't respect this relative order of phenomena in the world, then everything would descend into chaos.
然后我们的现在的我们的感官啊和我们的这个意识通过修心提升了啊提升了它的这个级别啊这样子的时候呢然后我们就这个会拥有一个高级的智慧这个时候以这个智慧去看这个世界的时候呢然后我们会发现啊原来都是我们自己的这个错误的错觉幻觉实际上这个世界就是一个虚拟的虚幻的世界没有一个真实的东西这个时候呢我们自己会感觉得到从这个智慧的角度来讲啊那么这个世界是不真实的这个世界是空心啊这个时候呢我们不讲因果这个时候就只讲空心啊这样子的。
However, when we're able to when we're able to develop our senses and develop our minds to a point that we can generate a kind of super or transcendental wisdom, then we will be able to perceive that everything, all phenomena, are in fact ultimately empty. And it's at this point that we will not speak of things in terms of the law and cause and effect, but we'll characterize them with the concept of emptiness.
就像我用我们的肉眼啊，看我们的前面的桌子，它是一个静止的物体啊，是一个静止的物体。但是如果我们用显微镜来看的话，这里没有静止的物体，全部都是运动的，一个动态，它不是一个静态啊。那么这两个，一个我们的肉眼的结论是这个桌子是静态啊，然后显微镜的结论，这个桌子不是静态，是动态啊。那么他们之间发生了一个矛盾的时候呢，我们会选择啊，显微镜的结论是对的啊，我们的这个感官的啊，我们的视觉的结论是错的。这个时候我们会站在这个显微镜的角度去啊判断啊。同样的，我们那个时候呢，就我们获得了一个更高的智慧的时候呢，我们就会站在从这个智慧的角度去说，哦，这个世界是虚拟的、空心。
It's like, for example, the way when we look at the table in front of us with our naked eye, we perceive an object that is fixed, that is stable.However, if we were to look at the same table under a high-powered microscope, we would see that in actual fact it's in a constant state of flux and movement. If we were then to ask which is the higher or which is the more superior way of viewing this entity, we would all say that we would be in agreement that looking at the object with a microscope is the superior way of understanding the nature of this entity.And it's exactly in the same way, once we attain the superior wisdom regarding the phenomena in the world around us, that we will see that everything is in fact illusory and empty in nature.
那么这样子的真物啊，这样子的空心，我们体会到的时候呢，这个叫做真物空心啊。那么真物空心有什么样的用呢？啊，因为我们这些烦恼，各种各样的烦恼，是我们把这个世界当作是一个真实的世界，然后这个执着就给我们导致了太多太多的恐惧、焦虑、忧郁，然后贪嗔痴这样子的太多的负面的情绪、烦恼、痛苦，这些痛苦的根源啊，这些烦恼的根源。就是我们把它当作一个真实的东西啊，那么这个时候把这个真实的东西，这个执着推翻了以后呢，啊，这些烦恼也都会推翻的，都会消失的。
In terms of the utility or the value of realizing the nature of emptiness, this really lies in the fact that our suffering, all of our suffering, is really stems from the fact that we regardphenomena in the world as intrinsically or inherently existing. Once we're able to overturn this assumption, well, and this assumption, our attachment to this assumption, causes us all kinds of negative mental states, delusions, fear, anxiety, worry, desire, ignorance, everything. Once we're able to overturn thisassumption or this belief, however, then these negative mental states will dissolve of their own accord.
比如说我们做梦的时候啊，梦里面的一切我们大家都知道是不存在的，但是呢，就是我们做梦的时候呢，因为我们不知道它不存在，我们正在做梦的时候呢，在梦里面的一切，我们把它当作是真实的东西，所以它给我们带来的这个结果呢，跟真实的东西是一模一样的啊，跟现实生活一模一样啊。如果我们不知道它是假的，但实际上它是假的，根本没有用啊。我们把它当作 真实的，那么它就变成一个真实的东西啊，它给我们带来的恐惧、焦虑，或者是高兴、快乐，所有的一切都跟我们的现实生活一模一样的啊。那么这个不是因为这个梦里面的东西是真实的，而是因为我们把它当作是真实的。
This is exactly the same as in a dream where everything that happens to us produces, feelings as if they were really and objectively taking place. Of course, the feelings, and the experiences that we derive from our dreams are not due to the fact that they objectively exist, but rather to the belief, our belief that they are objectively happening.
那么梦里面我们正在做梦的时候，我们突然啊发现自己在做梦啊，自己在做梦的话，那么梦里面的所有的这些啊恐惧啊，所有的这些恐慌啊、悲伤、焦虑啊，这样子的东西全部一下子就会消失啊，一下子就会消失的。有可能这个时候梦还会继续的啊，还会继续，但是它虽然继续，但是我们不把它当作真实的东西的时候呢，然后它不会让我们痛苦啊，就是这样子的。所以我们真悟空心也就是这个道理，我们知道这个世界是虚幻的时候呢，这个世界再也不会给我们带来这个恐慌、焦虑、烦恼啊，就是这个就是真悟空心的作用。
If in the middle of a dream, it suddenly occurs to us, we wake up to the fact that we are in a dream, then of an instant, all of our fear, all of our worry, everything that's happening to us will dissolve just like that. And even though the dream itself may continue, the fact that we no longer believe that it is real, we will not feel, fear, and we will not experience these negative states. We'll know that it's just a dream. And it's by the same logic, that, the realization of emptiness operates.
那么我们啊，现在我们所感受到的人间的福报，比如说我们现实生活当中的这个快乐幸福啊，佛释迦牟尼佛也不会否定这个，这就是一种幸福和快乐啊，他不会说这个不是幸福不是快乐。但是呢，这个就是啊，我们现在所感受到的比如说健康发财啊，或者是这个享受美食啊，等等等等，这个当中我们所获得的这个幸福和快乐，其实这个我们人可以追求的这个幸福当中最最最低层次的最低层的一个幸福，在这个上面呢确实是有很多很多非常美完非常美好的奇妙的这样子的东西可以去追求的。
The Buddha would not deny, the fact that many of the pleasures that we take as, happinesses in our life are in fact pleasurable, whether it be our good health or, the delicious taste of food we eat or the pleasure of being materially, affluent. These are all things that the Buddhist teachings would, acknowledge as a kind of happiness in their own right. However, these really are in terms of the, overall spectrum of happinesses that we have available to us, only really the lowest level. Beyond this, there are all manner of higher kinds of happiness, really beautiful and whimsical happinesses that are also available to us.
曾经啊，西方的某些哲学家会说过啊，因为我是一个世俗的人，俗人，所以我要追求世俗的快乐啊，当然可以这样子。比如说，你只追求世俗的快乐，其他什么快乐什么都不追求，当然这个是自己的选择，当然自己有这样子的自由啊。但是佛就是希望我们积极向上啊。其实人生就不仅仅是可以追求这么一点点的幸福，还有在这个上面呢，有太多太多的啊。至高无上的幸福也好，快乐也好，智慧也好，真正的非常奇妙的东西就在这个世界的 就身处，希望我们大家去探索，然后修心，这样子的话就能够感受到这个心腹。这个心腹呢，在佛教里面，这个就叫做大乐，就叫做就是极大的快乐。这就是说，已经超越了我们现实生活当中通过感官的刺激所获得的这个快乐啊，这个叫做大乐啊。我们像西方极乐世界啊，极其幸福快乐，都是一个意思。
There was once a Western philosopher who said that as an ordinary mundane person, we should seek ordinary and mundane pleasures. And whilst, of course, this is something we are entitled to think and entitled to put into practice, in actual fact, there just are so many much more higher, much more profound experiences of happiness and experiences of wisdom that we that are potentially accessible to us through our practice. So this, the Buddhist tradition, the Buddhist teachings encourage us to strive beyond simply the mundane pleasures of sensual or sensorial gratification and to strive to higher planes of wisdom and higher planes of happiness. These planes of happiness or these areas of wisdom are what we describe as great happiness or great bliss.And it's to these higher realms that I hope everybody applies themselves to exploring.
好，这个真悟空心，最终我们需要的就是这个真悟空心的智慧啊。但是呢，我们实际修行的时候呢，不要直接去修空心，还是从出离心开始啊，先修出离心。然后再修菩提心啊，或者是说我们先修四加心，然后再修五加心，然后一步一步的往上走，最后就真悟空心啊，最后就真悟空心。如果我们大家都稍微投入一点，稍微努力一点的话，就在这一生当中啊，就是在这一生当中临终之前，我们每一个人都有机会有出离心，有菩提心啊，甚至能够证悟空心啊。所以希望大家在这个啊正确的这个道路上面呢，稍微下一点功夫，这个对我们每一个人来说是非常非常重要的。
Whilst what we're ultimately aiming for is a realization of the nature of emptiness, this is not something that we should necessarily apply ourselves to first off. We should practice according to the proper stages by generating renunciation, bodhicitta, completing the preliminary practices appropriately, and then ultimately move on in our practice in this order.
好，今天的我们的这个讲空心呢，我简单的啊，就是一个简单的给大家介绍了这个空心啊，关于这个空心的修法以及这个空心的推理的方法，一些这个细致上的东西呢，我们今天因为是时间的关系没有办法讲，但是呢，大家可以进一步的去学习中观。还有就像苏大基堪布讲的这个菩提学会里面，像这个有很多很多龙树菩萨的这些轮大家可以去学习，非常非常有意思的。还有一个就是这个慧灯之光里面呢，也有一些通俗易懂的简单的一些空心的具体的修法和这个空心的介绍啊，我们要进一步的去学习，有兴趣的人都要进一步的去学习。
This evening we have briefly talked about the meaning of emptiness. However, we haven't had a chance to talk about concrete practices of emptiness or more detailed extrapolations of emptiness from the point of view of logic.So in the future, this is something that everybody should study for themselves. There are many materials available. For example, there are quite accessible introductions in the Wisdom Light book series. The Madhyamaka literature is something that everybody should study, and there are also Kempo Sodaiji also has a number of works that will be beneficial in this regard.
好，我们现在开始回向。So num de tam cha su ba nya to ne ni be da na ban she cha ji ga nan che wa long tu ba zhi bin zu lin zu wa zu wo shu o ma a hu ban zhe ge zhe ba ma se de hong o ma a hu ban zhe ge zhe ba ma se de Om Ahum Banzangar Mama Sudhu 谢谢谢谢阿弥陀佛